Ahoy, my hearties. Shiver me timbers and hoist the old Jolly Roger. There be a new Ask Mr. Duncan off the starboard bow. Yes, it's time to lower that anchor and take some well-deserved shore leave as I once again cast out my net into that sea of email questions and comments concerning the English language and my video teaching work here on YouTube. So without any more flim-flamming or lollygagging, let's have our first question for today.
How do we use the word literally in a sentence?
This question was sent in by Johann, who lives in Germany. The word literally is often used to show that the actual words used in a sentence are exactly as they are defined. Something that is being described is as exact as the words used to describe it. For example, I fell off my chair when I heard the news does not necessarily mean what it is saying. To say you fell off your chair could in fact be a metaphor used to show how shocked you felt. However, if the person said, I literally fell off my chair when I heard the news, then the person did actually fall off the chair with surprise. They literally did it. It actually occurred. It is not a metaphor. So we speak metaphorically so as to make the feeling of something happening more vivid. When we speak literally, then the events are exactly as they happened. The words used are literal. Thank you, Johann, for your question, and a big guten Tag to you and everyone watching in Germany.
A nice email.
I have received a nice email from Paolo, who lives in Italy. Paolo writes to thank me for my lessons, and he also explains how he uses my English lessons to help him with his studies. When he comes across a word he is unsure of, he writes it down and checks his Italian-English dictionary for the definition. Well, that is a great way of learning new words, and it also helps you to focus on the things you are unsure of. Never underestimate the educational power of reviewing what you have seen in my videos. Get into the habit of writing down the words and phrases you are unsure of. The thing I love about pre-recorded video teaching is that you can repeat each lesson as many times as you want. Video also gives you the chance to go back to certain points of the lesson for closer examination. There are also subtitles, which are really useful for when you want to write down those new words. Thank you, Paolo, for your kind message, and a big buongiorno to you and everyone watching in Italy.
How many words do I need to know to speak English well?
This interesting question comes from Danilo, who at the moment is living in Ireland. Believe it or not, this question is a common one that causes a great deal of worry and frustration for many language students. So, just how many words do we need to speak a language? 100? 1,000? 1,000,000? To be honest, the question you should be asking is which types of word structure should I be learning? It is all very well learning words, but you must also make sure that you are learning useful words and, more importantly, useful phrases. So instead of asking about the number of words, it would be better for you to try and learn as many phrases and sentences as possible. After all, sentences contain both words and letters. Understanding the structure of sentences serves many purposes. You will improve your grammar as well as pronunciation. Word usage, and also those small but important things in a sentence that can so easily be missed or ignored, such as the use of prepositions and tense. Knowing words is fine, but what you really should be doing is learning phrases. From my point of view, this is the best way of giving your word power the boost it needs. Returning to the original question, the number of words you need to speak English well is not fixed. I suppose it is more a case of what you want to say and how you wish to be understood by others. Let me put it this way. You can never have too many words, but you can always have too few. Choosing the right words to learn is important, as some words have various meanings. Prepositions and conjunctions are very important and will be needed if you wish to be clearly understood. Not only do you need to know the word, you also need to be aware of its variations. Past, present, and future tense, for example. How it is expressed in plural terms. So each variation is, in effect, a new word. So my advice to you, Danilo, is to collect as many words as possible. 100 words will limit you, while 1,000 words will give you much more choice. 5,000 words will make you very fluent indeed. But as I have already said, it is not the amount of words that matters, but what those words actually are. To be honest, you never really stop learning. There are English words in existence that even I have not discovered yet.
What does the phrase comfort eating mean?
This email was sent in by Jung, who lives in South Korea. The phrase comfort food refers to the action of eating something as a way to make yourself feel happy. Another way of describing it would be consolation eating or comfort eating. You attempt to console or try to cheer yourself up by eating something you enjoy. Perhaps you will eat some chocolate, or maybe a piece of cake, or a bowl of ice cream. Quite often, eating comfort food involves consuming something very unhealthy. The surprising thing about this action is that it can actually have a positive effect, albeit for a short time. For example, chocolate acts as a stimulant. It makes you feel more energetic and lively. The sugar contained in this type of food also gives your body an energy boost. Of course, the downside is that comfort food is, more often than not, very bad for you. Comfort food can become addictive, and in the future, you could end up feeling more unhappy than you did before. Thank you, Jung, for your question. And now, who would like a piece of chocolate?
It's special hello time.
You know I love reading all of your questions and comments, both here on YouTube and on my Facebook page. So I would like to send a big extra special hello to all those of you who have been following me over the past 6.5 years. And a big thank you to all those who have recently joined me. Don't forget you can follow me on Facebook. If you like looking at silly photographs of me standing by a pile of cow poop, or perhaps you would like to see some of those behind-the-scenes photographs taken here in my super-duper new studio in Much Wenlock, Or perhaps you simply want to drop on by to say howdy. It's entirely up to you. Thank you also for the kind messages asking about my move to Shropshire. I seem to be settling in here very well, and I have been busy decorating some of the rooms, as you may have seen in some of my recent videos. If you like the views of the countryside, then you are in for a treat, as I will be showing you some more of the beautiful Shropshire sights in future lessons.
There is nothing like a lovely cup of tea. There is nothing like a lovely cup of tea. It's delicious, it is sweet. Positively, it's a treat. Oh, there's nothing like a lovely cup of tea.
Is the ability to translate words easily a good sign of learning?
I give up. This question was sent to me through my Facebook page by Ahmed, who comes from Egypt but now lives in Saudi Arabia. The dream of most students learning English is to speak the language fluently. With this ability comes self-confidence and, more importantly, a chance to use this skill in other ways. Being able to translate one language into another is without doubt a valuable skill. Besides that, it is also a good way of measuring your progress as you are learning English. So my answer to you, Ahmed, is yes, the ability to translate from your native language to English is, among other things, a good method of practice. And it can help you to use your English language skills in many other ways. Who knows, Ahmed? You might one day find yourself working as a translator, traveling the world. I wish you good luck with your studies.
Time for a couple of idioms.
I love idioms, don't you? Here are a couple of idioms just for you. Red letter day. A red letter day is an idiom that means a special or momentous day, a day when something good or joyous happens. A red letter day could be the first day of your new job or a positive life-changing event. A red letter day can signify a new beginning. The idiom red letter day comes from the calendars that were printed with the notable dates and events written in red ink. Another great idiom is make both ends meet. This idiom expresses the action of spending only the money you actually have, to stay within your financial means, to only have enough money for basic things. My family has trouble making both ends meet. If you have to borrow money, then clearly you are not making both ends meet. You are spending more money than you actually have. You are clearly not making both ends meet.
Another nice email.
I have received a nice email from Sadeh, who lives in Iran. Thank you, Sadeh, for your kind words about my lessons and your question about my name. Yes, my name really is Duncan, although I tend to use the nickname Mr. Duncan when I'm teaching, as it seems more fun and quirky, just like me. While we are saying hello to Iran, I would also like to send a big hello to Kazemi, who is also watching me there, and writes to thank me for my useful English lessons, and wishes me the best of luck with my work. Well, thank you both for your friendly greetings and a special hello to everyone watching in Iran.
What are the differences between the words while and during?
This question was sent in by Corban, who originates from Afghanistan, but is now living in India. First of all, it is worth noting that both of these words have various uses. Some are similar, while others differ. We can use while to show the occurrence of one thing in relation to something else, normally an event or action. I'll wait here while you go inside. From this sentence, you can see that one thing is occurring at the same time as another. We do one thing while something else is happening. The word while can also relate to time. In this case, the word expresses the passing of time. I had to wait for a while in the queue. Here you can see that the exact amount of time is not stated. I was not served straight away, so I had to wait for a while. The word during is similar to while by the fact that both relate to action and its relation to time passing by. As one thing happens, another event is also occurring. I fell asleep during Mr. Duncan's lesson. In this sentence, we are saying that one thing occurred as another was happening. Many people had to leave their homes during the war. It is worth noting that one event is almost always longer than the other. You fell asleep for a short time, then you woke up again. So during does not say how long something occurred for. I like to take a nap during the afternoon. We cannot use while in this sentence unless we say, I like to while away the afternoon with a nap. In this case, we are using while away to express using up a particular period of time. While can also be used to mean though. While I agree with most of what you said, I still have some disagreements. Thank you for your question, Corban, and stay happy.
Almost time to say goodbye.
Well, it is time to raise the anchor and set sail, and for me to once more sail off into the sunset, as another Ask Mr. Duncan reaches its port of call or destination. Why am I using all these nautical sailing terms today? I have no idea. I hope I didn't go too overboard with them. Just in case you are wondering, ahoy me hearties and shiver me timbers are expressions used by pirates, or at least the ones that exist in storybooks and cartoons. Starboard means the right side of a ship, while port means the left. The bow is the front, and the stern is the rear or back end of the boat. Shore leave is time off or free time away from being on a boat. The shore is the land. An anchor is a large heavy object which is dropped into the water and holds the ship in place by digging into the seabed or by hooking itself onto a rock. Lollygagging means to fool around and waste time. That's definitely me done and dusted for today. I will see you all again very soon, right here in this little square box, for more fun and games in the world of English. Until then, this is Mr. Duncan in England, saying thank you for watching me, answering you, and of course, ta-ta for now. Ooh. That's better.